George, you must go.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, there are all sorts of other examples of that sort.
find someone that fits the role to right or left. And then what you do is you sort of move their arms passively to teach them about what things are. Well, it really doesn't work so well as if you have them engage in interacting with the world. Well, we go on about examples of this sort of action-oriented nature of perception. And also, I really don't know a great deal at all about Buddhism, but there are some interesting things that come up from time to time in some of the texts on this particular subject, and mainly that I've gotten through talking with Eleanor Roche at a colleague at Berkeley in the psychology department. And her notion, or one thing that was said, well, if seeing doesn't lead to action, then of what use is seeing? And I quickly translated that into, if hearing doesn't lead to action, then of what use is hearing? And, so I think of our auditory facility, and there isn't anywhere near the amount of experimental results about how it's action-oriented. It certainly must be. And I would think, and in fact, I get sort of worried about the state that when I reflect on this, maybe we can reflect on this collectively, that in music today, you know, we're really experiencing music in a somewhat different way since the advent of the recording. And, well, you know, it used to be, in fact, even when I was a youth, my mother would come home and play something on the piano, or she was always performing. Not really well, but she that was part of the thing was actually play the music, and play the music you just heard in the theater, and so on. And nowadays, it seems that we have a lot of our musical experience is presented in a passive form. Well, it seems like there's some kind of dilemma there. Maybe, I don't know, I'm actually going to argue after it's all said and done that we're really listening well, let's say, or we're listening actively, and we actually have something like a body in our mind, a model of the body, and that's probably a very important part of our listening experience. So, but anyway, I do worry about this aspect, and I guess I don't get too tormented by it, but I do think that if one is engaged in controlling something, that one ends up sort of hearing it or seeing it somewhat differently. And let me give you a couple of examples from the mind. I once watched a trombonist that wasn't jarry taking the deep tape that he was asked to write down what notes were being played. He was actually synthesizing the sort of slide position to help in the process of recognizing what he played. Oftentimes, when we think about how we recognize and hear speech, there's this notion of actually acting in the speech. There's for a long time in the speech perception literature, there's something known as the motor theory of speech perception and others. But that one didn't work out so well. The point I want to make here is that we seem to perceive by sentences. There seems to be an active, we're actively constructing the world. This sort of fits in with this embodied perception notion very well. So there are other examples of this analysis synthesis, and I think you all have experienced this when you're reading your text and you realize that words are missing. At least when I'm proofreading, I'm always synthesizing the missing words of the text instead of having someone else go over my text because I can't see it anymore. Possibly fooled by what I see. Another thing that I think is worth pointing out is related to how the mind, in some sense, mirrors the world and the experiences we have with the world. And this notion, we were talking about it earlier, when effort came up, and about how effort is perceived. And I think in music it's very important that the sense of a dynamic in music, I believe, has more often to do with the sense of effort that's perceived. I mean, we can very easily recognize a scream as, you know, a loud a vocal utterance of some kind, even though the level on the playback system is turned way down. And we don't necessarily get that same emotional experience out of it if we turn the level way up. And so there's something about the sort of signatures on these sounds that have to do with their, how they signify the effort that we play. And I think that's very important. So we're perceiving things as if they're oftentimes emanating from objects in the real world, even if those sounds are synthetic. One of my favorite examples along those lines is this experiment. I like to talk about experiments because I was trained as an experimental psychologist, and I really, and I, since there's a philosopher here, I feel like I have to get some revenge. So let's say that over here in this glass, we're going to have a listener. And this is a loudspeaker that has a little light bulb on top of it, right here. And here's another loudspeaker quite a bit further away that has another light bulb on top of it. But these loudspeakers aren't even connected. Hidden from the view of the listener is this loudspeaker where the sound is actually coming from. Now, what we do is we're asking the listener now to indicate how loud he thinks the sound is coming from this speaker. The light goes on, this sound is played. He judges the loudness, then we randomly mix everything up and present this one, yet it's still coming out of this speaker. So he's visually seeing two different distances, and guess what he says about the loudnesses of these two sounds? They're always the same. Any guesses? Tom, you know this.
One further away is louder?
Yes. Yeah, very, very strong effect. One that's further away is judged to be louder. Because if it's the same level and it's that far away, my God, it's got to be really loud. An example of how the visual system and the auditory system are interacting, and yet how we're sort of judging things with respect to what the source is like. Not what the experience is like, but what we infer about the object out in the real world. Well, I mean, I certainly go along with Trevor, which are really, I do like to think about these fantasy things. So, but if we as musicians or composers don't realize that the people who are receiving these things have the world mirroring in their mind, then, I mean, we should think about that. In other words, I don't think you can just be arbitrary in how you build sound material. One should think about the ontology of that sound material. Okay. Now, any questions on these remarks? I just maybe summarizing. I want to argue that we need to interact with the world, develop a full-fledged perceptual apparatus, that we in fact, have in our mind some kind of model of the world. And so those are the two points that I think I've tried to make so far. Yes?
Ask a question just about that experiment.
Yes.
Did you try that with all kinds of different kinds of EQ, for example, with a very bass present sound with hardly any top? Or did you try it with like extreme?
Well, I didn't actually do this experiment, but no. It wasn't done. They were at the same level. And indeed, there might be a bit of high frequency loss in there because of the external. It's always kind of here. See, I didn't fool myself. It's always one of them. So it's the same. It's always the same sound. The sound never changes. The point is the visual context. But yeah, if the high frequency was rolled off, then it might help suggest that it's further away.
Yeah,
because we know the type of thing. But no, the idea was that it's always the same, it's just this visual view of the screen that tip off as to what the actual the experience of obviously. Okay. Anyway, let's move on a bit and let's talk a little about this control business. I'd like to make a distinction between what's called exploration. when we're trying to provide a good match between what we intend to happen and what really happens. And we really want to get, you know, I want to say ah, and I hear ah come out. But, and so the goal of control is to match, have the, you know, the change that we, you know, the artifact that we produce in the world match the intentions that we have. But that's not what we do all the time. I mean, most of the time, at least for me, I like to spend more time not so much worrying about this control problem as worrying about the exploration problem. Now, what's the exploration? The exploration problem is one where you essentially try to learn something about the relationships between control commands and the resulting design. In other words, it's not, I don't have a goal. I'm going to babble. In other words, if I were exploring my speech apparatus, what would I do? I'd babble. I wouldn't, you know, I'd go, I had an instrument, I would try different embouchures, I'd try different positions. I wouldn't necessarily have any desire to create a particular type of sound, just exploring the space of an instrument, exploring the relationship between the various controlling influences I can have on it and the final outcome. Now, I would like to argue that for most of what we do in motor skill learning, that we need the proper combination of exploration and control. In other words, that we need to have some. If we don't explore, well, I don't think Michael Jordan got to where he is without a lot of exploration of the outcomes of his, you know, the various gestures and so on. And then, of course, once he knew something about the relationship between his abilities to move the ball around and what the ball actually did, he was then able to have his intentions go into play and make the ball do what he was done, and then correct errors at the same time over this whole loop. So, I don't know if that clarifies the result, but I was hearing a lot of nervousness here in the audience and among the speakers too about the idea of being in control, that somehow was a negative connotation or something. But on the other hand, I don't think it does. I do think that exploration, on the other hand, wants to include this, and we can see that a lot of times what I want to do is really hear, at least in my own musical explorations, I want to hear something happen, and I'm not sure at all what will happen, but I'm interested in learning something about the relationship between what I did and what happened. And I can do that without any specific intention. But on the other hand, I like another situation to be in control, so to speak. That is to say, I want to get this effect. I want this to happen and have it happen. And perform, learn how to have a grip on the feedback that allows me to bring things under that kind of control. And it's sort of oftentimes very good called control system. Now, it turns out that those very ideas that I talked about are really kind of important subjects in robotics, and they're important subjects in what's called the inverse problem. The inverse problem is, it's a good one to just mention, I don't want to go into technical detail. Let's say that I'm trying to build a synthesizer by looking at the way an instrument works. So I look at what the instrument produces, and then I look at the control variables that are going in, so I'm actually looking at the control variables going in, and now I'm going to look at what comes out. But somehow what I want to do is figure out how to get the right control variables to produce the desired result. So I want this super good ah to get out of my mouth. So I want to find out, what do I have to do to produce that? And so I have to sort of invert that to get back to the controller input. Well, the paint factory might have this difficulty. The bucket of paint comes out, and you want to get a certain recipe out of the whole thing. That's much more interesting than if you're a restaurant. So I've got this dish that's just wonderful, and now I say, how could I sort of invert the process of producing it and figure out how to produce that for some two sets of girls? So I sort of look at the problem backwards. And it turns turns out a lot of such systems aren't invertible. You can't really do it. A lot of the natural systems that work in the world, you can't do that inverting because there's many of the ones. The problem is the number of variables involved. Degrees of freedom problem, so the technical jargon, I don't want to get into it. Let me just say, speech appears to be one of these things that you can't simply invert. And so we've got to invent this new business. And this is the exploration business seems to help solve that problem. Okay, I'll leave that aside. Now let's talk about the bonding business for a minute. Some more. Does anyone know Neil Todd? I have to say anything about him. He's a really interesting music cognition person. He's at Manchester now. And he's been very strong on the notion that the way our body works has something to do with the way we perceive and produce rhythm. And he's introduced the notion that maybe what's going on in our motor control center in the brain, which is located back here, called the cerebellum, is really a model of one's body, one's own body, and how it works. And he speaks about this in control theory terms, and he talks about it in a forward model. And he suggests that we, in experiencing rhythmic music in particular, or music that might be called groove-based music or something like that, there was actually pulsation going on, or a strong rhythmic pulse, that we're using this model to experience that music. In other words, that we're actually doing this sort of analysis synthesis process with this internal model of our own body. Well, how much you... Now I'll tell you the experiment we did, but it's only one of many. I don't want to... This seems like a crazy thing to do. He said, well, what I would do is go around and just make a bunch of measurements of the body, and like the width of the shoulders and length of the arm and that sort of thing, and then see if any of those measures of the shape of the body correlate with what's called the personal tempo. Now, the personal tempo is where you feel the groove is. Paul Press when you talk about it this way. But the idea is if you ask someone to just tap at what felt like a good rate, they tap somewhere between about 300 milliseconds between taps and 900 milliseconds on the other slow side. So this is what in musical terms is called the tactus, or in everyday language is the beat. And people have somewhat different preferences for where they do their best. And there's another way you can get at it. There's some tunes like Three Blind Mice and the Blue Television and so on that actually have the same rhythmic pattern, but you hear the tune as Three Blind Mice, which was played in slow tempo, and Blue Television was fast, and then et cetera. So he used a variety of techniques to get his personal tempo, and lo and behold, is the width of the shoulders correlated rather highly with the personal tempo, with the big, broad shoulders being slower than the narrower. And so this sort of locomotion idea was tied into it. And I know it sounds like a sort of quirky experiment. Neil's a quirky guy, but I found it very interesting and part of the configuration of results. So there's another one that I really like. This one surprised me. This is called the bimanual advantage. And here, if you just tap with one hand and you look at how much slop there is in the tapping, so how accurately are people tapping? What's the variance slop? So you just tap with one hand and you measure that with an indication of the degree in which the inter-beat interval is varying. And then you ask people to tap with two limbs this way. Well, guess what happens? less variance, markedly less variance. Three limbs, markedly less variance. Four limbs, even less. So, I, now, every time I watch a drum, I can't tell. Notice this kind of tendency to have all those limbs going at the same time. Now, the theory of why this is so is a bit hard. It's a bit hard to explain. And I'm not going to go into it, but I can give you some references about the debate that's produced in the Motor Skill literature, and about the debate in particular about what, it about what kind of clocks we've got in our system. The multiple clock theories don't work. We don't have a really good theory of why this binomial advantage works the way it does, but it's a very clear and strong effect. Again, indicating something about the body in our production, and more than likely the perception as well. Okay, let's see. Any questions? Ah, I know that I have to say something about this. It seems to me that much of what we're doing, another kind of topic thread that ties into these other things. I want to say something about what's called in the motor skill literature and so on, automaticity. That is, like walking on a stone-filled trail. You know, we can do that without stumbling too often, anyway. And talk to our partners or the walking map. We can actually navigate a fairly rough and varied terrain in a way that seems quite automatic, or at least involves what might be called tacit knowledge. As a non-conscious interaction with the world. In other words, we don't have to have all of the detail of the terrain available in awareness, but just in unconscious awareness in order to navigate. For some reason, in a lot of, let's say, aesthetic judgments that have been made over the years, it seems to me that automaticity has sort of been downgraded, all this happening like this automatic pilot, right? And what art could that be? Well, I'd argue that this tacit knowledge, or these kinds of activities, could actually make a great deal of use of what the environment is, and are highly acculturated. That is, that they have a lot to do with the kind of culture that we did, that would have to do with the playing of music, performing of games, etc. So, I wanted to say a few words about that, and I'm struck by a book that I recently got, and I haven't read. It's awfully thick. It's called The User Illusion. This is by Tor. George, help me out again. Neurochandra. Yeah. Well, this his argument is that we've overrated the role of consciousness in that. In other words, that the user illusion. I think that's the title captures it. Somehow we're in this sort of state of conscious control, when indeed much of our ordinary, everyday, all the time activities are passive, are unavailable to us, but yet highly acculturated and attuned to the world. Okay. I'm going to stop there and then I'll move into practice. Yeah.
This last point, it's true, especially for motor skills. On the other hand, information that one has learned in order to tacitly navigate the world. And I think some of that learning, which is again, I know it's been mentioned for me a lot, finding a thing that will change your perception of yourself in the world and gives you access to more knowledge on a perceptual level.
Yeah, I think so. In fact, it must be that what one does when you're doing mindfulness, it must be that trying to be mindful is something like this, where trying to get access to this kind of passive knowledge. And maybe that, I think mindfulness maybe is being something like that, but then I'm also reminded of this, I think it was a Philip K. Dick short story that I read some years back. I can't remember the exact title, but here was a man who decided he was going to gain voluntary control over all of his sort of inherent I would agree with you very much. I'm only trying to, the scale is so heavy, it's probably weighed on the side of the study. Knowledge that we have available in some symbolic, simple, use for what that kind of, and the idea that...
I think we'll experience a lot.
Yeah. Well, you know, maybe this is a, let me say something about the form that some of this knowledge may take in the way it would be written. Neil Todd argues in his work that the word that he uses is, the cerebellum is a Smith predictor. Now, let's not worry about whether Smith predictor is wrong at all, but I mean, it's very specific about a certain control theory model. Now, let's say you've got a big plant of some kind, like a chemical plant. You're trying to, you know, have the input variables that you're dumping in there and so on, produce the desired result at the output, maybe that bucket of paint I referred to earlier. Well, that process may take days. In other words, there may be some operations that take a long time, and then by the time you end up with the final result, the feedback loop is just too long to be corrected. So the only way to make this plant work efficiently is to build a model of the plant that you can use to predict the behavior of the plant, and then refine the model of the plant. So here we are with, in our brains, the model of our bodies that enable us to make predictions about where they are. This model is trained. This is probably part of that whole passive knowledge network. So I would kind of see it.
David, when you develop an instrument, this passive knowledge is something you deal with or you try to avoid dealing with?
Let's talk about just an example. Yeah, I have some examples where I think it's clear that I think about that.
Because
I don't worry, I test it.
when you develop a new instrument, that the passive knowledge might not be available, or you might be happy with the fact that it's not available.
Yeah. Well, let's see what happens. Let me shift gears a bit to the other musical examples now. Okay. So what I'm going to talk about now. Yeah. You have another question?
Yes. Just hand me a mic in the case of puppeteer. In case of puppeteers and theater people, they do. I was just thinking about what you were saying. The there's a tendency to try to program that kind of response, so that because instructors practice over and over again, there are things that I can do now as frontiers, a little bit like working on learning to ride a bicycle, that are now involuntary. I remember that I had to learn this, and I spent hours and hours and hours practicing certain gestures, which have now become unconscious and involuntary in the sense that they become part of the practice of performance. And it's something that any actor tries to accomplish, just by repeating the gesture over and over again, so that it becomes as quote unquote natural as walking down the street. So there's that kind of that introduces the possibility.
Well, I guess I'd like to ask you, let's imagine that you suddenly found yourself with a misadjustment between the height of the stage, or some variable went wrong, that would mean you'd have to adapt your tacit knowledge to a new situation.
And how much the correction bearers is built into it.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, when you move a puppet arm, string might have loosened up a little bit or something, and as the arm moves outward, unlike a human arm, there might be a little bit of a wobble, which you, with your fingertips attached to the rod, will immediately correct. Mm-hmm. Like the idea of the chopsticks.
But I think, as you were talking about
this, there
were much of and if there's more than one thing going on, it's true that the learned motor skill activity is going on and varied according to conditions. But simultaneously, a performer also directs their attention. Directing their attention, responding to, for example, when you were talking about the size of the audience and how a change in the size of the gesture so that somebody far away could read it. And this is all real-time, online processing that occurs, and it has to do with not only the tacit knowledge and the skills, the motion, but also an inclusion of direction of attention and attention. So I think all of these, it's important to distinguish and include all of the learning when you think about it.
I think that the physicist David Bolman has an interesting idea on that one, the concept of enfolding and unfolding. And that always the example that he gives is riding a bicycle, where in order to keep up, you always have to turn into where you're falling. And if you think about that, you can't do it. But if you enfold that knowledge in, and you unfold those conceptualizations that you need to allow you to keep track of what's unfolding, so then you can see all those things as part of the one continuum, with only certain aspects coming to the surface.
Because that's the kind of consciousness too, that where the other point made about consciousness is that to think I am now going to do this with conscious activity is not only thought. The body is the action, but it's not only thought. Thought is one part of it.
Which all consciousness can be established to a performer is to someone trying to climb a ladder.
Maybe a certain form. I guess I don't know what consciousness is. But on the other hand, I do know what this is, the sort of, you have this ability to sort of explain and control it in some sense. But I think, for example, that we can have a kind of purely musical consciousness, for example, that we can actually have a reaction that is in some sense at a level of awareness about what we're doing. I mean, I'm not speaking about the automaticism, which is just a musical thought. And I'm sure that artists can have visual thoughts. And a lot of thought is non-symbolic, non-Cartesian theater. Maybe any other? Yeah, back there.
There are two things on those. There are recent experiments in England on this problem of taken the instruction and they made sure the response action was faster than conscious thought, but they couldn't actually shut down the autonomous action in time to keep themselves from reacting to the second movement to the dog's screen. So there's a sort of like, there's a very tight coupling in real time between these two things, but they are actually separate, appear to be separate populations. The other thing that on overland motor tasks that is sort of confuses what we call a conscious action or intention is that if you have an overland task and then you consider it in such a way that you come up with a description of it. Let's say you're very good at something and then you describe exactly how it is that you accomplish it. Usually the problem that occurs sometimes is that the person ends up believing their description instead of remembering how it is that they accomplished the action. At that point, they execute the description and they're much worse at that point, whatever that overlearned task is at that point. It turns out that only a lot of times the only way to relearn an overlearned task is to somehow describe it. So if you've got an error, it's one of the few ways that you can actually access those things. But if you take a perfect thing, something you're perfectly good at, and you're overly conscious of it, it will actually. The funny thing is that traditionally psychology has always been considered to be overlearned tasks are always considered to be trivial, which I like the idea that it's actually the substantial thing.
You just maybe opened up some focus. Well, I don't know whether we can do this now or whether it's appropriate, but I'm just wondering what it's going to be talking about descriptability of a task, and to what extent that should be made up with the family, how far limitation can go in musical or choreographic systems. How much do we flog the dead horse? I think that if we discuss improvisation without in parallel, raising issues of communication and the prescribable action as opposed to what we call the privilege.
I think in that context, the idea of the idea of creating a notation which is actually the overlearned tasks. And then you assemble those.
Well, this is what I think. Wasn't that what Tim was doing? He was getting this alphabet business with the juggler. That was a fascinating thing.
He's also talking about the fact that there's already
sort of set of the body's algorithms, things I've learned, and I'm guiding around. I don't think about it in notes at all. So, with that in mind, why not try to put some of that knowledge about performance practice and so on out into the synthesis of it itself, not other generative things. And then build the interface in such a way that you can drive that around and be convincing about it. I don't know if they've succeeded, but the idea was that instead of having a gesture, a touch gesture in this case, produce just a single musical snap like a note, to have it control a whole phrase of notes or a whole an algorithm, but yet keep the ability to turn on a dime, to be silent when I wanted to, or to move in a different direction in an improvised context. So that's sort of the goal of what I'll try to talk about next today, but in a very simple way. So indeed, it wasn't so much having automaticity with respect to the interface, but putting the automaticity in the underlying algorithm that was used to generate the musical sequences and saying, well, this is part of an acculturation.
So, we had a pianist, a classical recital pianist who specialized in Russian music and was being in the dinner house very often, and they came and she wanted to learn the improvises. And it turned out that the only way to help her was to give her a MIDI keyboard, because it was a problem because she always would end up with the same Russian phrase kind of movement. So we could help her a little bit by reprogramming the relationship between keys and notes by basically turning decoupling the relationship. Mm-hmm. So she couldn't rely on the notes.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought of developing an instrument that consciously disrupts the passive movement?
Well, since I didn't have any to begin with, I mean, just think about part by, I started from zero. But we've done. I mean, I haven't done this. Now you're going to make me think about doing it more seriously.
On the computer itself, this is not really
interesting. Yeah.
There's a very thing with that example you see, because like the Russian guys come, and she has all this knowledge, which maybe is passive knowledge now, but something within the Russian brain about that music and getting better in that culture. So, and then suddenly you say, well, we don't want that cultural knowledge anymore. Let's forget all about the previous history. And
she asked.
And then we say, well, of course, that makes a lot of sense. But then the way of doing it is to say, well, you disrupt that by changing the effect. You can't, when you make these culturally mediated bodily actions, you're not going to get that same result that you expect. So suddenly it's a disruption, not only of that physiological and person's history in the same way, but you sort of need, maybe that was a way of doing that, because at that point, well, but then the premise I found difficult, which was I can imagine it didn't, because then somehow real improvisation consists in a sense of disruption of one's history, which may or may not be clear, maybe then not. Maybe there's a way to improvise while in harmony with one's.
No, but this experiment was basically drawn to make one the only step that was possible at that time, you know, is to explain how much knowledge there was already in her playing and how much she was in her own way in that sense. And that she needed to go very deep, you know, in rebuilding the new freer form.
But I don't understand that, because what if you just decided that she wanted to improvise using that rather than just disrupting?
It must have been that she really wanted to make
it. She wanted to. But so that the idea, well, I'm just trying to figure this out, is that our player can get a different sound, or?
She wanted to learn to improvise. She had been at the Wim House, and she really liked the way those people play together. And she had tried, but she couldn't. She would always come back with parts of, you know, little surfaces she didn't. And, it was pretty interesting.
Let me just go down the sort of technical details of this situation and sort of what we'll talk about along the way. There's this wonderful singer that I had a chance to meet 2 years ago,
somebody else in the Pakistan. This is a North Indian or Hindustani North Indian classical music, but actually I would say it had its really origins in the Mughal courts and it's primarily Muslim. Now, this music was something that I just loved and had the most incredible respect for. And I had no intention in this meeting we had to, I would actually, no thought occurred to me that I would be in a situation where I could actually be involved in performing with such a musician. Because of, you know, probably because of Peter Gabriel, because I couldn't imagine doing just some kind of world music. This wasn't any kind of agenda that I would have. And so we were down in the studio. I mainly wanted to figure out something about the music. So I had this opportunity to record him in an isolated manner, putting the drone in his headphones and having his father come in and play harmonia to get some data that I could look at. I wanted to understand all those squiggles, all that wonderful expressive information. So one day after a recording session, I was mixing a piece that I'd done for another singer named Tom Buckner that I'd worked with, and he was listening to it and he started singing. And he said, "Oh, that's kind of interesting. What are you doing?" And so I was in this kind of little, very modal, very few notes. I didn't have a lot of notes in this thing. So, he said, "Well, I'd like to try that or something." And so we then decided to rehearse together. Me and he started singing, and he started singing, and I was playing this kind of instrument I constructed. And out of the computer program, I was running a mini synthesizer, and I was using an instrument from John Buca, a controller called Thunder, which I was driving along. Well, anyway, one thing led to another, and here we are. Getting concerts. And now this is a bit of a problem for me. As I said, I didn't like the sort of fusion model of you know, East Weeks. I mean, that thing is sort of like Yehudi Menuhin plays with Ravi Shankar. I didn't like that. You know, there's something wrong about it. And the same thing was something, not wrong, I mean, it's just interesting, but it didn't work from my point of view. And nor does some good times when you sort of have this drum machine playing. I don't want to go to cultural. You know, I've got liberal guilt, by God. You can't imagine.
For the record, let me just say that Ravi Shankar, I thought it was cool.
I'm expressing this problem I have about that I can't be an Indian musician and all that. And so the idea was that I could maybe understand enough about the abstract principles that guide what sort of, here we go, the musical universal number. But, you know, maybe I could figure out some common ground that features of his music that I could figure out that work in common with my, what I could do on the computer. And that the common ground would be sufficient for a real musical dialogue to occur. And that the result would be something different from, I wasn't going to try to be just a tabla player, but we're going to stay in the, I wasn't going to ignore the tradition, his tradition, trying to learn as much about it as I could in a short time. But I didn't have any idea that I could possibly move up that level. Anyway, so let me say now some things about the technical. So we did a couple of concerts there, but so what I have is this controller, and the nice thing about it is I can sit on the floor with it. Now that I actually was sitting on the floor with the controller before that. So when we were on stage together, we were, you know, sitting on the, I wasn't like up on the
different rhythmic algorithms running. It's a rhythmic engine running on each. And it's running, and it's silent. And it's running on a time base or anything like that. And what I can do is get into it. And this was touch sensitive, so I could dip into it at a certain location on one of these sort of virtual slider up things. And by the pressure, it would control the velocity or the dynamic. And where I dipped into it would say something about the timbral quality. So I had a kind of dynamic timbral strip for each of the eight voices. And then for my thumbs on four other strips, I could control the properties of the algorithm, the type of density, and how much dynamic relief there was, and so on. And the thing that I can say also is that I built these algorithms, I kind of knew how they behaved. So they were automatic. So I could dip into them when I wanted. I could dip into them when there was going to be a sound or a particular strong beat. So I could move my body back and forth. I mean, actually get my shoulders moving and my bimanual advantage, you know, as much as I could. Hook up to the rhythmic. I mean, I think about it, ever since I learned about that, I'm thinking about how I can more actively time my body. And so I'm dipping at certain times to bring up the sound that is underneath, but running along all the time. So that's one kind of idea. An example I'll play is a percussion thing. Now, the other idea is a colleague, Matt Wright, who works with this at Fenmac, has been working with what's called the Wacom tablet. And, we can show it. Why don't you show it? Because I get, he has one here that's embodied in this sock. Anyway, this is what what people use to do drawing. It's a pen based interface, and the pen can sort of function like the mouse on the screen. But what's really interesting about this kind of interface, this Wacom tablet, so here is one. We had a somewhat bigger one, so we move the pen around like this. And the coordinates, both the pressure and the XY coordinates are sent to the computer, as well as the tilt of the pen. And on one that we have is another little knob, so there's a little thing like a spray gun that you have. And you turn the pen around, and the drawing people use it like a eraser, but it can actually function in a different way. And then you can use different pens as well, and they all do separate things. So you can actually have two pens or a puck in your one hand and so on. So it's an interesting thing. And what's interesting about it as well is that it's very, very accurate. Ours was something like 32 bits worth of data we were getting out of it, I thought it all. But anyway, nothing like MIDI. This is not the 127. It was way, way more accurate, and way more accurate than the mouse control. So we were able to get in there and wiggle around in a very sort of virtuosic way. So we've been working on additive synthesis of vocal sound. So we actually made a synthesis of based on Chopped Icon's data, which we'll hear in a moment. And so we would have parts, the rod itself would be laid out along the extent of the tablet as spectral frames. So it's actually the data needed to synthesize a particular fine fragment of sound. And so if you move the pen across the display at the normal tempo, you get a full, very convincing signal. But if you move it along and play this note, lift it up, play another note later on, you can move around in the melody and play all kinds of different. Or you can go a little backwards, you can sort of swirl around inside the note there and keep the note alive, and so on. So it makes something about the structure of the music at the same time can be very expressive. And then the amplitude can mean something, the pressure, in this case the pressure was related to a kind of whistling effect that it was deeply pressed down, and you had a full-blown voice. It was just light pressure. You had only one component play that you kind of whistle. And the nice thing about it is that you could get into some sort of relationship with the singer, because this is his material. And Matt, who's playing this, is just accompanying him. And so you'll hear that. And now, so there's just us two. Everything else is additive. All additive synthesis is except for some of the percussion that we're able to sample. And I'm dipping, playing the percussion part here. The drone is on a kind of automatic pilot, but there's this ability to intervene, sort of like the cruise control on the car. You can actually change it along the way and make it more. And then a lot of this, all the other voices that you hear, there's only one real acoustic voice here. All the rest of it is totally electronic. And then the other thing about it is totally improvised. There's any plan set, the pitch set that started. So maybe if I could just start right there. We'll listen to about 5 or 10 minutes of it.
Da 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 गति ना करी
setting up voices and bringing them down into this region so you can do the scanning, the squiggling, he's down there with these minute gestures. And people were saying, what are you doing? And they really had a hard time appreciating the relationship between the actions on the stage and the result. And so this is a problem. I mean, Leticia and I have discussed this a lot. Now, the Yara, what? Yeah.
Is it what was physical?
Yeah, I guess that would be it. I know.
But he has a way of presenting himself in concert. Very still. He hardly moves well, and he's totally rid of the fact that he's not moving. And he's playing. He has a very slow gesture, and it works for his music because of the way he presents it, the kind of culture that he's doing. And so I can imagine he's kind of probably the only person.
I think that's even
a problem.
Sound of the resulting sound, it didn't have to be very abstract. how sound signify effort.
Okay.
Which is what I, and maybe a sound can signify effort, maybe it can signify everything, but it's sort of intentionality, connection, sound, kind of connect someone. The person yesterday said there was a tie, his hand, his dog's tail, and he tied to his hand, his tail, he tied to your own tail, and probably going to get a sound. So I'm looking at, he waved around in some way, and maybe, I'm just trying to figure out, is there a sense in which you can, do you think that sound's doing because of effort, and do you think that it's sort of your effort, or the effort of this thing that you recorded?
Well, let me tell you what I tried to do. So if you have, let's say, a percussion sound, and you play it soft, and you look at the spectrum, you see that this is as rich as if you hit it really hard. So there's a kind of, in signal processing terms, is the bandwidth that signal grows with the intensity of the excitation that you make from it. Same thing is true with trumpet sound. If you play the trumpet very softly, it doesn't sound as bright as if you play it loudly. It's much broader bandwidth. So when I use the pressure that I to control the mix of high frequency content and low frequency content, so I can make the drum sound like this soft, lightly touched, or very loudly touched, and I built that into the sounds to map my effort gesture to what might be perceived as effort in the sound itself. Likewise, in Matt's interface, he had a way of making the voice get louder or softer, in addition to this business of making it whistle. That was another, there's a tilt I can use. He had a couple of different ways of doing it, but he was using tilt for that. And when the voice got more intense, he brought up more high frequency components. In other words, put a little bit more high frequency output, which is characteristic of a vocal sound that has more effort associated with that sound. So it was a kind of a, built in.
Well, but I'm really not seeing, I mean, I sort of started, this kind of, I feel like that, I mean, if I didn't have to do it, I'd still get the sound of effort. I mean, especially if you went into a small effort, you get that sound, because I have like, bust as much as you can. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you could just sort of like do that. I mean, there's some sort of, even there's a disconnect for me there. It's not a critique of what you're saying. It's kind of, seems to be a premise that I'm sort of trying to question that somehow it's better to do it. You can touch a little bit and you say, that's what I'm doing. It's not really as tough. It basically sounds the same. Well, will it sound the same? I mean, I'm starting to get the idea that are we saying that somehow that this sort of motion is done, you make right the mic mapping and light scaling is going to give us the same sort of feeling? And if it does, then, it's a difficult question for them.
If I wanted to get loud, I guess what I'm wanting to say is when I try to make things loud and soft, and that's important to do. If I want to make it louder and soft, when I make it louder, I usually change the spectral content as a general principle of good sense. So that's different than turning up the knob on just the level. That's all. I mean, it's just it's sort of like a common practice. A lot of people use that synthesis, try to build that in. Now, a lot of times it isn't built in. You don't kind of have time, but I do try to do that. But, and whatever my effort might be, it might be some algorithm thing running that's putting various accents on it that I'm not even controlling it anymore. I would try to put that in so that things would, sound more appeal to this feature of that nature that we're used to hearing things that are hit or struck. It's kind of like building physicality into that.
Well, there's this notion of that because, like, we're talking about listening to someone play the instrument, then the next step is you put tape on it, and then somewhere along the way, when you get into this sampler, just you and sure you can use sample sound all you want, but then there's some other dimension of the articulation of these sample sounds that it doesn't work. It doesn't provide that analogous situation. So you come up with another
since most of the people have seen it for ages, and well, not 4,000 years, but I think we are in an intermediate stage where explanation is needed.
Yes.
And, but since we're doing exploration, it's going to change every time. So if you can't find an instrument that fulfills our explorative needs and find the need that it, you know, satisfies the audience's needs. So we have to bridge that. And I think it's our effort as well, in, you know, the explanation before we start.
Yeah.
I've seen you do it.
Yeah.
It works.
Anyway, any last thing? Thank you very much.
I just wanted to mention, I mean, apropos the symposium, I didn't do this book, this book, I just got it, and I read about a third of it now, and it seems to me a pretty worth the effort, particularly given the topic of this symposium. This is called The Hand, and it's how its use shapes the brain, language, and human culture. So it's all about the sort of, there's a lot of this stuff on fluid manipulation. He's a Spinoza neurologist and seems to know a lot about cognitive science. And I recommend it given the topic of the symposium. I'll leave it up here on the desk and look at it later.
You want to take a break?
Well, theaters.
Musique.
Musique.
Yeah.
Das
Musique. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.